All right, we got a selection from the Dexter Manley. Now, even though this is the Sound of Philly SOP, McFadden and Whitehead, it was a jam back in the day when you guys were getting it done, winning games, playing in Super Bowls. Riggo, ain't no stopping them now.
I don't know about that. But there ain't no stopping Coco Riggins. Today's her 16th birthday.
What? Hey,
yeah.
COCO 16.
You believe it?
Whoa, ain't no stopping her now.
Right, we go for on Saturday, we go to get her driver's permit. She got to go take her test on Friday.
Oh,
or Saturday, I'm sorry.
Gosh.
So on Saturday. So we got it rolling at the Riggins house.
Now, is that the wife and yourself taking her to get the driver's test?
No,
or
I'll
just
do that.
You?
I'm, for whatever reason, I've been the driving instructor. I taught my older daughter, Hannah, I taught her how to drive, and I'm working with Coco now, so.
Yeah.
Coco's pretty good. You know, the first thing I teach him?
What?
Is being a country boy, farm boy. And I guarantee you, Dexter, if you know this, I'm going to just go, I don't believe it. When you back your car up, do you use your mirrors? Or do you just look behind you to see where you're going?
I used to look at the mirrors.
Do you?
Yeah. When I first, I looked behind. I started when I was driving, looking behind.
When did you switch over to using your mirror?
When I had a few accidents.
From backing up?
You remember at Redskin Park?
You in the semi?
I ran into Babe Laufenberg's car. It had a nice little dent on it.
You know what?
Good for you.
You just reminded
me. How about you, Todd?
No. I'm a neck guy here.
See, that's what a farm boy learns right out of the blocks. You know, you got to back a vehicle up. But more so, you know, usually you got a trailer on the back of your vehicle. So you try, you know, and a two-wheel trailer is something, you know, I can almost do that in my sleep. But you give me a four-wheel trailer, and I don't know how many people can back up a four-wheel trailer. I mean, that takes a special skill.
No question.
I mean, you know, because you go the opposite, you turn your steering wheel the opposite way.
I can't really explain it,
but I can do it. You know what I'm saying? But what throws you off is if it's a four-wheel trailer, you got to turn a wheel the exact opposite you would a two-wheel trailer. It gets pretty complicated.
If you start thinking about it, you're done.
But anyway, yeah, I'm in charge of the driver's ed at the Riggins household for the girls.
Okay.
So we got that going. And I'm also in charge of the manual labor that goes on around. Remember we talked about 2 weeks ago about the dirty, nasty jobs?
Yes, yes.
Well, I caught one yesterday, Dexter. We got some trees that died on us, and I've got some trees coming on Thursday.
All right, so you went from...
Yeah, from
gravel.
You know, after yesterday, I made the executive decision that I will get the bobcat on the...
So the gravel project, how many tons of that?
I ain't doing it. There's 20 tons there. You can't really appreciate because it goes back
behind. Is there still like 19 and a half left?
Yeah, right at 19. Have I done 1,000 pounds? I don't think so. Maybe 500 I've done. But the point being is I was considering that until yesterday when I started digging these holes out for the trees that are coming in. I still got 6 holes to go. So later, when I leave here today, I got to go back and do it. But I got to tell you, we did Dexter's charity last night. Yeah, there you go. They're about 30, they're about a yard wide and they're 2 feet deep. So you can imagine, that's almost a cubic yard. It isn't quite, really. It's a little bit shy. I could do the math. But a cubic yard of dirt digging that with an idiot stick, let me tell you something. Dex, I know why you walked off that job in Stillwater.
You know what an idiot stick is?
Yeah. No, why you come up with
shovel.
These terms,
that's
man.
A shovel, man. That is a shovel. And if you don't think it's an idiot stick, grab a hold of it. Because only, I don't want to asperse the fine folks that have to use one of those, but let's just say it ain't on the top of my, it ain't high on my list of priorities of things I like to do. But, you know, the good thing about yesterday, I didn't have to work out. I mean, I was so exhausted. Literally, I found myself like I was digging for a while. And I'd have to stop. It's like I was running wind sprints, Dexter. I was panting that hard and sweating like I was going to the electric chair. I couldn't. It was 70 degrees out yesterday. Beautiful, beautiful day, 70 degrees. It might as well have been 95.
I was going to say, it wasn't humid.
I couldn't have sweated anymore if it had been 95.
Well, John, let me ask you, how's your heart?
Well, it passed yesterday's test, so I'm guessing, you
know. He's here today.
I'll know later this afternoon if it goes okay. Just giving you a reprieve today. I'm going to shut down on you, but everything's good.
Yeah.
So anyway, that's what I got looking forward to. And then, of course, Coco's birthday dinner tonight. I will have to curtail. I don't think I might get all 6 done, but then Coco's request for her birthday, 16th birthday meal is Swedish meatballs. So I will get on get on top of that.
Very Are you cooking a Swedish?
Oh yeah, yeah. I said, I'll go out there. I've got six more of those holes to do. When I leave here, I'll go give it a shot, and then I'll go back in and put on my what do they call that thing? A toque, my chef's toque, and
there you go.
The meatball.
Hey, Dexter, you're not coming over to help?
I can tell you right now, the brothers wouldn't be doing that.
What, Swedish meatballs?
No, digging this hole.
Yeah, it's true.
Yeah.
So you were gonna try to hire him out, but I think, you know, we did Dexter's charity event last night for the Dexter and Lydia Manley Foundation, your initiative to help folks learn how to read.
Very
successful.
Down in inner city.
Washington, D.C.
Yeah, that's an excellent thing to do. Yeah. Really, that's the key to, I mean, that's A, the key to learning, I think, learning how to read. And A, it's kind of the secret of getting along in a civilized society, knowing how to read. Now, you always want to know what those newspaper people are saying about you.
Todd said he's going, can I pick up the check Friday?
Yeah, you can. Or I told Lisa Marie, because I was waiting to get the information in who to make it out to. I know you'd like me to make it out to Dexter Manley.
Dexter told us last night, guys, I'm going to need your donations. I said, how do you pay him? And he goes, you make it out to me.
I said, not Dexter,
I think we got a little tax deduction coming our way as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, you know, we love you. We trust you.
I wasn't quite sure.
By the way, Dex, if you, I think that Lisa Marie wanted me to invite you over on Saturday for a cake and ice cream if you're available Saturday evening. Although you may be asleep at that hour. I mean, it won't be late. But I'm saying around 7:38.
Oh, maybe. I'm up.
You'll still be up on a Saturday night?
I'll be up.
All right. You got an invitation?
Good. Thank you.
Can I bring my wife?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Good. Well, actually, it's Lydia we're inviting. We'll make you wait out in the car.
Yeah, and if you want to donate to Dexter's charity, and we hope everybody does, check out DexterManleyFoundation.org and donate for a great cause.
Yeah, well, thank you.
All right, so Riggo's with the physical labor.
Yeah.
And he did offer you a chance to come over and help out today.
What do you need me to do today?
Dex, I couldn't do it. I wouldn't wish that off on my worst enemy. What I was doing yesterday. Well, I might. I'd think of something worse than that. But you know, it was pretty. It. Like I said, I was so tired. I went in and I laid down and I took my daughter to tennis. And while she was at tennis, I said, I'm too tired to drive home. So I just fell asleep in the car. And it seemed like she was there for an hour. It literally seemed like she just got out of the car and the car door was opening back.
That was some good rim there.
Oh, it was nice.
Is she a good tennis player? This Coco you're
talking
about? I think
so, yeah, Coco. Yeah, she's all right.
That's a good sport.
Yeah,
it definitely good sport.
Well, speaking of sports, let's go ahead and get into this Burgundy and Gold and what the heck's going on in the mighty NFC East. So let's start where we last left off. They went up to New Jersey and... Just give me your impressions of the game, Riggo.
Yeah, well, the game itself, they played a bad team, and but they're a bad team. But you know what? Through all this stuff, there's things that I'm looking at, and we talked about it last night. I'm going, you know, I see some stuff going on there. They got some pieces.
Yes.
And it really gets down to, you know, are they going to be able to put it all together? You know, clearly, the defense, you know, they did some pretty good things, really. I think what they only gave up one touchdown, wasn't it?
One touchdown.
They gave up one touchdown. Once again, the Giants aren't a great football team. And they don't have a great offense. They've got a young, struggling quarterback as well. But to me, I see guys on defense. A couple of players that stick out right now. And they're the players that you need at those positions. I think Montez Sweat right now, if I had to vote, would be the MVP of the. And I know that Fuller's done a great job making some interceptions, but I have to say that he's starting to remind me of Randy White.
Yeah,
playing a different position, but that guy, he's got a motor that doesn't stop. I'm telling you, if you're a ball carrier, you better be thinking, no matter when you get in the clear, where's Montez Sweat? Because he'll be getting up off the ground and he'll be chasing you. I really like what he's doing. And, you know, Chase Young obviously is going to come along. And, you know, I just had this thought, you know, in a weird sort of way, I'm not predicting anything, but they kind of have Manley and Man in place now. You could make that argument.
You're a smart guy.
Huh? You thought the same thing?
I thought the same thing.
Yeah. I think that you got that. Let me tell you, you're getting that. That is a big piece of the puzzle, having pass rushers that can come off the edge. At least that's my opinion. And, you know, I think they're running back by committee. I think McKittrick and Gibson Those guys are making people miss and getting extra yards when you think they should be tackled. And then you got McLaren at wide receiver. I think, you know, this guy's going to be an all-pro someday, if not this year, when they get, you know, when the quarterbacking gets up to the level that it needs to be. And then the tight end, I think,
Logan Thomas out of Tech.
He's shown a little flash. You need your offensive lineman to kind of settle in and you're getting Sheriff back. And so I see more good than I do bad. And it's kind of funny because they're very fortunate that they have, if you will, to where you don't have to write off a season. You know, they're in a division that's so bad that, hey, it's not over, but quite a bit. And they get Kyle Allen to improve on his, you know, the turnovers. I'm telling you, this team, you know, they're not going to be a great team by the end of the year. I don't think that's true. But they still could win their division for what it's worth. I mean, somebody's got to win the damn thing. Why not them?
Yeah.
What do you think, Dex?
I give you my take is that I think that the offense is still struggling with some identity. Like Gibson, they always start out good. This guy seems to pick his holes, and he has great coming out of the backfield. But during the course of the game, you don't see him anymore. And I think the offensive linemen have given up maybe 20-plus sacks in 4 football games.
Do you think that's a function, Dexter, that the defense gets off the slow starts? This team is always playing from behind. And the defense, for whatever reasons, damn near every game that you see these teams are marching down the field, getting on the board early, and then they get it together. The defense gets it together in the second half, but then the offense is because they do seem to abandon the run awfully early and easily.
Well, you know, it's funny you say that, Tod, because that you just triggered something in my mind that I thought of that I haven't thought of in years. And that goes back to teams that I played on that were very similar, where they sputtered. One side of the ball was getting it done, the other side of the ball was caca. Then it would be then they're caca, now they're playing well.
Right.
It's like, and it really does get down to, it's like an engine, you know, it's got to get tuned. And that's really what they're missing. And I don't know, I think Rivera, I kind of like what he's doing. I kind of like Riverboat Ron. With, you know, the way he, you know, I think he's been criticized for the going for the 2 points on Sunday and by some of the local people. And I'm going, well, yeah, anytime a play doesn't work, you can second guess all you want.
Right.
And
right.
Occasionally there are obvious situations where you go, well, I think that was a stupid play. But most of them, when they're criticized, is, well, you have the benefit of, you know, hindsight's 100%. But, you know, there's every likelihood that they would have completed that. They win the game. They've now won 2 games. They got a little momentum going. They get the, you know, they get the Cowboys this week, you know, but they don't. So they got, it's always, you know, that's a thing, though. You always got to start from zero when you don't win. So, but eventually, you know, then you tack another win on and you just don't look too far ahead. And that's really what they got to do. It's literally one play at a time. The way I see it. And I, you know, they're growing. I mean, you see individual play. Like I said, I can't say enough about Montez Sweat for some reason. I just love the fact that this guy never quits on any play.
He sticks out.
He has a motor.
Because in a weird way, you'd think Chase Young would be that guy.
Right.
But now that I think that really last year he was playing, I'm talking about Sweat, playing in a position he was unfamiliar with. He's finally starting to own that defensive end position, and he's starting to catch on to how everything works. And I wouldn't be surprised if he actually becomes, you know, really the dominant defensive lineman that they have. But as he should be, he's a first-round draft pick, not as high as some, but he's still, you know, he's still a talent. And like I said, I'm very, very impressed. And McLaurin's another one. You know, when you look at guys that are, you're looking at all-pro type guys, there's
right.
two of them right there.
Well, you see the motor. You see the possibilities. Yeah. And they've made some spectacular plays in their short tenure here. Dexter.
Just continue this talk about Montez Sweat. They had a nice run play. He went and caught the running back.
Yeah, he did. Across the field.
Oh, yeah.
He ran
from
down
the opposite end.
He ran down the running back.
He ran him down.
Yeah. And I mean, that's Dexter-esque.
Yeah.
You know, Dexter had that kind of talent where, you know, running back gets in the clear, Dexter gets an angle, and this guy ain't necessarily in the clear.
Well, I tell you what I did once, and they chewed my ass off in the meeting. We was playing the Dallas. Herschel Walker first year came to Dallas, and, you know, he could run. And he hit the hole, and I run right on the side of who go outrun each other, and I never tackle him.
You just want, you just got in a foot race.
You got in a foot race.
You when you could have tackled him,
I could have tackled him.
I see your point, Dex. It's like hey, the TV's on.
This guy, I'm a track
star. Not that fast, folks. I'm faster.
Yeah, and Richard Pettibone, especially Target Torgerson, they lit into my butt. They really
so
did.
So you were having flashbacks of Daryl Green tracking down Tony Dorsett on Monday Night Football. Hey. You're like, Herschel, what you got?
Yeah, Daryl ain't the only guy that can do this. Yeah. But I tell you, on that extra point, I thought Kyle could have made a better decision. He was so indecisive. If he kept running and run toward the end zone, he could have scored because it was open field. He had a corner coming and maybe a linebacker coming across. He had a lot of real estate. He could have make those extra points.
Well, I thought the same thing, but then I think that in his mind, in real time, down there on the field, that he felt like they did have an angle on him and that he wasn't going to quite get there. That's my guess. I don't know.
Yeah.
My point being is that he's got a good sense about him as far as if he thinks he can score or not score, and I just think that he didn't. But, they had great defense up on that particular play. You know, it's just one of those deals you run into. But you know, you have
So to, if I'm you hearing you guys correctly, you don't have a problem with him going for the win in two points.
I didn't have a problem with that. I just thought that the 2 points, I'm sort of indecisive. You know, I'd rather tie the game up, but at the same time, I want to go for the win.
And, you know, you see both sides of the coin here,
right?
And literally, because, like you said, John, if they score, they're a hero, and everybody's talking about Riverboat Ron's back, Riverboat's Ron back. But I think the one thing that the analysis looking back is the defense was playing well in the second half, especially in the fourth quarter. And, you know, the Giants didn't have anything.
Yeah.
So, you know.
Right, that's a good argument, too.
Yeah, and it's like, and so one of the quotes that we saw from Coach Rivera was, well, we were on the road, and statistically it says on the road you should go for two. And they're like, going, the road? I mean, there's no fans, there's no nothing. There's that big a difference. It's statistically that, you know, usually that's based on a real home game, non-pandemic related, in a packed stadium with people in your face versus why not take a chance on your defense being stout, because they had shown up once again in the fourth quarter to shut them down. Well, take your chances.
Well, I tell you what,
that's legitimate.
If Dustin Hosswood missed that first field goal in the first quarter, the score probably would have been tied up. Remember, he missed a 48-yard field goal.
No question about it. So,
well, you know, here's something that occurred to me, though, that you look at that when you're playing a team such as the Giants, I don't know because I've never coached, and I don't know exactly.
Do you ever kick?
What's that?
Have you ever kicked field goals?
Yeah, in high school.
Okay.
But I never made one.
Well, you had to be a straight-on kicker, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I kicked extra points. But what was I going to say? It seems like, though, when Riverboat goes, you know, rolls the dice, there's a part of me in the back of my mind that's thinking, is he doing that because they got nothing to lose, basically?
Right.
Is that kind of the theory behind it?
Right.
For something, in other words, it's like, why not? How bad can it get?
Well, through 6 weeks.
Or is it, hey,
it's tough to follow the logic and the reasoning behind a lot of these comments that has our attention. And Kyle Allen is proving to be Kyle Allen. He was the turnover machine.
Yes.
Under Ron. And he was the second. He had the second highest turnover ratio, fumbles and interceptions. And for a guy that played as few snaps as he did, I mean, it was not good. So, you know, that reared its ugly head again.
But is Riverboat Ron living up to his reputation, Riverboat Ron? Gambling.
Well, he is, yeah. But I think, you know, with Allen, he's one step forward and one step backward. They, you know, a lot of times they say two steps backward. It's not two. But he takes a step forward, then he takes a step backward, which they got to eliminate that. You know, and I think Scott Turner, I think this is his first year of play calling, isn't it? I mean, he's learning on the job a little bit.
A little inconsistent,
so,
too.
Yeah, and then, you know, you throw in that the offensive line could be a little better. And the running game, you know, they do. This is the thing, what we talk about. It's inconsistency, which is exactly, you know, that is the bane of all, you know, mediocre to poor football teams is inconsistency. Everybody, you know, in the NFL, all 32 teams, eventually during the course of a season, all that, they're all going to make plays. But it's a team that can do it more often, you know,
right.
You know, with consistency, they're the teams that end up winning stuff. And that's the team that usually ends up winning the Super Bowl. So that's what they really got to work on. They've got some things to work with here. But really, if this team
if they had a quarterback right now that was on top of his game,
right,
I think you would see a different football team. And and you know this as well as I do, Dexter, the offense definitely doesn't really influence necessarily the defense, because the defense has got a job to do. You got to go out and do your job. But from an emotional standpoint, a defense likes to be able to see an offense put some points on the board, because the pressure constantly, and when you have no offense, the pressure's constantly on the defense. You can't let them score. You just can't let them score. And, you know, that's like being on a tightrope. You know, after a while, your legs get tired. So, you know, that they've got to balance things up a little bit and start to become consistent on both sides of the ball. And I don't know, you know, who, you know, is it the defense that plays a little shaky in the beginning, and so the, you know, they get behind, or what, are the offense then the offense then finally starts showing up? I don't know, but they got to figure it out.
I think the OC never seemed to go up top. He doesn't go up top, man, go for the long ball, or whether he's protecting the line or trying to get away from There's no vertical game. There's a reason for that,
I think. That's got to be. And, you know, like, I'm not a student of the game, but my logic, sense of logic tells me the last thing they want to do is come up with a second and, you know, 15 or a second and 19. Or then, you know, you get into where you're getting sacked. I mean, because the drive gets really weird, because you've got to figure out how to get back part of that. You know, if you're going to try and get it all in two plays, I don't know. And I think they're scared to do that because I don't think they think their line can hold up long enough.
Is it that, John, or do you think it's also the lack of confidence in the quarterback position? Dwayne Wild.
Well, that's true.
Wild all over the place, had a couple of bombs here and there, mm-hmm. but again, and you're trying to groom a kid and really concerned about turnovers. Kyle Allen, clearly they're not taking the training wheels off of him either. Like you say, to stretch a defense and give you more options. And Alex Smith, all we saw were dinks and dunks and get rid of the ball when he came back.
I thought it was six times, and I heard this week it was seven times, but that can't be right. It was six.
It was a lot. So
yeah,
let me ask you guys point blank right now. Dwayne Haskins' experiment, is it over? Is it over
here? I think with the attitude, it's over.
Yeah, if it's what, you know, what I perceive it to be, which is, you know, Dwayne's got a little bit of growing up to do, yeah, I would say it's over with. And, you know, at the same time when you say that, and this is the part where you kind of go, really, guys? You know, this is where you have to be a little bit critical. In the off season going into this, still to me, now maybe you can make out of what you want, but I don't want to pick on him because, you know, he really did something very courageous a week ago, and that's Alex Smith. But what's Alex Smith doing on this roster? I think if anything else, you know, he went out and got sacked six times. What's that tell you?
Right.
You know, that he's done. And, you know, he's a liability. You know, God bless him.
Right.
That he should. We were saying this 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago, wondering what's he doing out here. I just don't see Alex Smith as being the same guy as he used to be. He's an older player. He's not part of the future.
He's 36 years old.
Right now, I'm thinking, you know, okay, but the future is, as George Allen, you say, right now. And so I just think that's a roster spot, and I don't know what you'd do with it. Maybe you won't improve your team that much, but that, to me, I think you could look at and go, now that's somebody's looking past something there. I don't know what it is.
I think Dwayne Haskins have rode his ticket out of here, but I also think the Redskins want this Trevor Lawrence. I think they're going to pull off some kind of trade and bring this guy in.
Well, you know what?
I think that'll turn the team around. Go ahead.
Yeah. I mean, look what Joe Burrow's. He's kind of bringing excitement to Cincinnati. I mean,
oh, no question.
It's stunning to a certain extent how some of these kids come out of college and they just roll right into it.
But it is a crapshoot. It's a crapshoot, and for every Joe Burrow,
you know,
you look around the league.
There's a Tim Couch, or there's a Ryan Leaf, or there's a Dwayne Haskins.
You know, Carson Wentz was questionable, but now Carson Wentz is playing well with the team up in Philly that is, listen, here's this stage of the season, very early on, every team has a lot of injuries right now. I mean, clearly, that's the lack of preseason and what's in this pandemic. But Philadelphia, in particular, along with the 49ers and the volume of guys that they have lost that are true starters, I mean, Carson Wentz came back and they fought back against, they were down 17 to Baltimore and came back and almost pulled it off, which leads us to the NFC East and the stats that we have posted up here on the screen. In the, you know, we called it the NFC least very early on here on the John Riggins Show. And through 6 weeks, Dexter, the combined record of the NFC East is 5-18-1, a winning percentage of 208, tied for the worst ever.
After 6 weeks.
After six weeks with the 1984 AFC Central. So this is truly remarkable. I mean, somebody is going to win this and have a home playoff game. You win your division, you get a home playoff game. This could be 6-10. This could be 7-9. So if there ever was a chance for a young team to fight their guts out and find an identity to grow upon, why not this team?
Well, I'm gonna be a riverboat runner. I'm gonna say 7-9. Redskins gonna come up and win the division.
Bold statement.
But and that's the weird part about it that I think. I was saying this the other day that you know you can laugh all you want with a team that goes into the playoffs that way, but they get a home playoff game. And which you'd see there'll be teams out there that won't make the playoffs at 10-6.
Right.
And yet here's a team that, 7-9 that's in the playoffs, and you're going, and it does. You make it from when you look at a competitive system that really doesn't reward. It's kind of weighted in a way just based on if you're in a division, there's got to be a winner with a playoff.
Geography, baby.
Yeah.
But it really is cyclical. I mean, again in the 80s and how good the NFC East. For about 10, 12 years, dominated the NFL.
Well, what I wanted to say was that even given all that, that some team is going to come out of the NFC East and they're going to win the division and they're going to get a playoff game at home. And you never know. I mean, if it really goes like this the rest of the season, then you do know. But you never know out of one of these teams. And like I say, I go back and say, why not Washington? One of these teams can catch fire. And if that team starts playing well at the end of the season, Washington leads a couple, three more games.
Mm-hmm.
And all of a sudden go on a tear and start winning game after game after game. Confidence starts to soar. Team has to come here and play them. They're feeling good about themselves. Early election returns or whatever, not necessarily going to predict how it's going to turn out the following day when they announce the winner.
I think the strength of their football team is the front four. I think if these guys can continue to get to the quarterback and make plays, they could turn.
But Dexter, here's where I'm going to challenge you on that.
Okay.
Because number one picks across the board,
right?
Preseason hype. Oh, the front seven of this defense, led by the front four. Do you realize they have 16 sacks through six games, and they got eight in the first game against Philadelphia? They're not stopping anybody.
I agree.
And so they're not living up to their hype and the one thing that everybody felt really good about. So to date, they have not. And what's frightening, and I think positive in a weird way, only two quarters of football, the second half against the Eagles in that first game, the offense and the defense put it together. Mm-hmm. And so out of 24 quarters, two in which offensive, defensive clicked and actually come together. So you got to find that magic. But to me right now, I am really tired. And when you get all these announcers that come in, the national announcers, and we talk
about it.
And these guys, they don't really know. They're reading the press clippings and they're reading all the marketing stuff or whatever. But when your defense by most metrics is not good. Your offense is abysmal. Your defense is slightly better.
And the bad part of that is that your defense, because it was hyped to be really the strength of the team,
right?
And basically it's true. I mean, you got four first round draft picks lined up in a defensive line. I mean, my God, it should be. I mean, extremely dominant to work. In that sense, there should be no running game against this defense, is my opinion. Because the linebackers, that's what a great defensive line does, doesn't it? It keeps all, in a run game, they either stop it at the line of scrimmage or they funnel everything to the linebackers because they keep, blockers off the linebackers, and the linebackers there to make the play. And that's something they haven't done. But, I go back to what I said. I'm still optimistic for some reason. I just think that at some point that this team will, Kyle Allen will come out of his, I don't want to say it's a funk, it's just that he's got growing pains that he's trying to get through.
Mm-hmm.
And, and they play in a division where anything's possible. I guess what it gets down to is the game against Dallas on Sunday. Because what's his name is the former quarterback in Cincinnati is now the...
Andy Dalton.
But in a way, you kind of go... That could be dangerous, although I think Dallas' defense, I mean, if your offense is going to do anything, Dallas' defense is, by all
things that I've heard is atrocious. They're giving up over 30 points a game.
They've been terrible. They got lit up by the Arizona Cardinals last night. Kyler Murray and them had their way with them. It was embarrassing. In Dallas lost another key lineman. Martin went out, and he's in concussion protocol. They're all pro. They're not sure if he's going to be available this week. Dalton, CeeDee Lamb, the wideout rookie who's been their shining star of defense. They got Vander Esch back, but this is an opportunity for the Washington football team this week to make a statement. Do you realize he could be in first place?
They
could be in first place because Philadelphia and the Giants play each other on Thursday night. So let these pillow fights begin.
That's not what it is.
Yeah, I'm not giving up on the defense. I still feel that the defense is the strength of their football team. But what I have noticed is that a lot of teams come in, they run a lot of play action. That sort of don't allow the defensive lineman to pin their ears back and go get the quarterback.
Well,
go ahead.
And John, well, no, I'm just, Dexter, you and I talked about this earlier because the other thing that sticks out to me about the defense, don't you find it that big third downs, they rarely shut anybody down. Their third down percentages, it's still not good. They give six. The Giants were 7-for-11 for 64%, but it seems to be in the key opportunities, a big moment in the game, they can't get it done. They can't stop them.
Can't get off the field.
Right.
Yeah.
I will say, don't you believe with the adjustments they've made with Kendall Fuller and in the secondary, is looked sharper. What has been going on back there. But
That gets better when you start getting more pressure on the quarterback.
Bingo.
So, I hear everything what Dexter's saying. I'm wondering, too, a little bit. I mean, Chase Young, he's a youngster. He just, he's only played a couple, three games here. Montez Sweat's finding a new position. And yet, you got to really, like I said earlier, you got to love the guy's motor. I mean, he's all over the place. The other two guys, Payne and Jonathan Allen. It's kind of like, well, they've been here a little bit long enough that, and Jonathan Allen seemed to be, but he doesn't seem to be this year.
Right.
Was the leader kind of in the last year or so. And now he's not who they
– He's a veteran now.
Yeah. I mean, his third or fourth year.
This is his second
year. No, Allen's at least third.
At least three and maybe four.
Yeah. Okay.
So he's been around long enough, but, he doesn't seem to have, increased his visibility any as being a leader anyway. But, yeah, I agree with you. If they can start getting after the quarterback more, it's just going to make your defense, your secondary that much better. And I think the linebacker play needs to be improved. Now, they got Holcomb back last week, which I think was a good thing for the defense. But, a lot of that has to do in the runs. Like I said, if the defensive lineman can at least, stop the offensive lineman, they don't get a surge there, and keep the linebackers, keep blockers off them, they're supposed to be there to make that tackle at the line of scrimmage or give up a yard or so. And too many running backs are, breaking tackles and that kind of stuff. That stuff's got to stop.
I agree with that. The Redskins giving up 5.2 yards per run. That's not good.
That's not good at all.
Yeah. It's bad. It's bad. So, what do you think the line is? This is a home game here in
FedEx
Field. Cowboys. What do you think the opening Vegas line is, Dexter? Who do you think Vegas favors in this matchup?
Oh, no question. They're gonna favor the America's football team. Well, how much do they know?
I don't know.
They're pretty good, Dex.
I think it's like a pick 'em.
Oh, no. The line opened at -3.5 Dallas. Now, since last night's game, some books have it down to -1.5 because Dallas had, it is.
I mean,
then a couple of books have taken it off the board based on some of the injuries last night, in which they will reevaluate to see if Martin comes back and plays for him. And if there's any other injuries of note that might affect the line, but it's getting closer to a pick 'em.
Is that when they say a pick 'em? Is there such a thing?
Oh, absolutely.
In other words, Vegas just says now you just pick a winner. There's
absolutely.
No spread.
That's right.
I'm learning too, Dex. I'm not a gambler.
Yeah.
Well, sometimes it's fun to have a little sweet action on a ball game, especially when your team.
Why do they always call it sweet action?
Because
always talk about sweet action. I got a little sweet action.
Well, because
what's sweet about it?
It's the man's
because
game.
Now you have an interest in the game where you might not have any interest. And
I prefer not to have an interest.
I'm riding with Riggo.
Give an example on Sunday's game, had you taken the Giants for the longest time, you're going, okay, this is going to, oh, ooh, no, okay, finally. And then the last minute touchdown.
This is when sweet action turns into, oh my God, what have I done?
Exactly.
What have I done?
I don't like
that. Then there's that. Yeah. Then there's that. But it keeps it interesting. It keeps it interesting.
Well, I can see that.
Well, we've analyzed everything going on with the NFC East here. This is still an opportunity, and you keep seeing the development and the emergence of these young players that everybody wants to see, and let's see where this goes. Are you guys into the World Series at all?
I haven't watched one thing, couldn't tell you who's in it. No, I think Los Angeles, they're in it, right?
Yep. Which Los Angeles
team? Oh, and I know
team?
The other one, too. It's a Florida team.
Yeah, yeah.
And I don't know which one. Tampa yeah, Bay. The Braves.
I like it how Dexter's over... Like he's hiding it from me. He's hiding it from me.
Excellent. I would have never guessed Dexter knew or had any interest in baseball. How'd you know that?
I don't like baseball, but
yeah, but how'd you know it?
Well, because I watch television from time to time.
So well, I do too, but I guess I don't
what's interesting about this in the wild, wacky pandemic world of sports that we've had this year is
right.
So the Tampa Bay Lightning won the Stanley Cup. And
Stanley Cup.
NHL.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Hockey.
Yeah, yes.
LA Lakers just won the NBA championship.
Right.
Now you got LA Dodgers and Tampa Bay playing for the World Series. So everything's based in Tampa Bay.
Is this the rubber match?
This is, you know, they got, and Tampa.
Title Town, is that what they're going for?
Look at this. Tampa's got Tom Brady and Gronk and the boys and the Buccaneers.
Yep.
And no fans are able to see any of this in person.
Yeah.
But Tampa, they got it going on.
Yeah, yeah. That's true. I thought the same thing when I forgot, but you're right that that Tampa had won the Stanley Cup. And then, you know, between LA and as I said, one of them's going to be Title Town at the end of the
year.
There
you go.
It's possible, I guess. Well, if Tampa. No, they can't. And Tampa doesn't have an NBA team.
They do not. They?
Yeah, no.
That's
no.
What they don't have.
Orlando.
But I was hoping the Astros take the Rays.
The cheating Astros?
Cheating?
Because Houston. Todd, okay, Houston.
Todd, I got to stop you right there.
There is no cheating.
I will go back with what I heard when hanging around with military people. I think it's the Army. It could be the Marines, maybe Navy, maybe Air Force, maybe all of them, the Coast Guard. But they say, if you ain't cheating, you ain't trying.
And I'll work with you on that. I like that.
I guess that makes sense to me.
I like that.
Yeah. Do you think Belichick cheats a lot? At least he used to.
I'm thinking, well, I know until he passed away, Don Shula used to call him Belichick. Now,
true.
I don't know.
Bill does not have a very fun reputation among some NFL coaches, I know for a fact.
Yeah, which makes you, I mean, and, you know, of course, a lot of that you got to figure is jealousy.
Success.
Yeah.
With success.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But it's like, I suppose these old masters that look at the grandmaster, if you will.
Who's the grandmaster?
I guess it's Belichick. I mean, he's the new Vince Lombardi,
yeah.
I guess.
Yeah,
right?
Yes,
he's the new paradigm boy for the guru, right?
Yeah.
But they look at him, and they're all trying to do, like, with the old slide rule. You know, they're trying to figure out, how's he do this? And they're figuring, basically, they come with, well, he cheats. Well, it's kind of like Al Capone in a weird sort of way, and I don't want to say that there's anything criminal about Bill Belichick, but the U.S. government, they knew it, but they couldn't. They knew what he was doing, but they couldn't pin him down. Finally, some guy said, income tax. And they went, okay, we'll try that. Yeah, we got him on income tax, and they threw him in a can, and he never left.
Yeah, I tell you what, I'd take Joe Gibbs over Belichick any day.
Yeah, something to be said for that.
I think so too. I do. I
have to agree. Because he's a cheater.
I think that the reason that I would much rather play for Coach Gibbs, for Joe, is that you know he let you have fun. He let you do what you want to do.
There you
go. I got a feeling that it's Stylog 13 up in Boston. You know,
it's what
I just,
now?
You know, in other words, not a lot of fun, like a concentration camp up there.
Yeah,
I mean, it's basically, it's like mind control when you get there. Even the players themselves, they start to work on you, you know, like take Randy Moss. Now, this guy was a cut-up, had a lot of fun. Remember when he mooned the people in Green Bay? You know, Joe, the announcer, Joe Buck is still trying to get over it. I can't believe that. going, Joe, that's one of the funniest things I've ever seen. What, have you lost your mind? Of course, maybe he was doing it in the back of his mind. He's laughing, but he's thinking, I got to say this because the league expects me to say it.
That's true.
Exactly. Because you had to be. But then all of a sudden, Randy Moss goes to New England. Next thing you know, he's a good community guy. Yep. I mean, what's the deal?
He got his mind right.
Yeah.
Well, exactly. You was a community guy. You know, when you had your nice day, you would bow to the crowd. But you never moaned him.
No. I had no reason.
John was more theatrical.
Well, I mean, I never thought of it. I thought Randy would—he was way ahead of everybody because, we should have, you and me, Dex, together in Dallas, on the Star, moon the Dallas fans, but not just figuratively. We should have really just dropped our pants and let him get a full eyeball of what's going on.
Well, I tell you what I did one time in Dallas. I was a little ticked off that Jerry Jones invited, Elizabeth Taylor, and to do the coin toss and some other people.
Elizabeth Taylor, the actress.
Yeah. She was there doing the coin toss, 1989. And I never went, I was a captain, I never went out there and shook their hand. I just turned around and went back to the bench.
Because? What was your motivation?
Well, because Jerry Jones was grandstanding. He had all these people here. Like, we get ready to play a football game. We got time.
You weren't having this Hollywood crap. No. Dexter wanted some heads.
No, Dexter's got a great point here as far as what he did down in Dallas, turn around and walking off, because he was here to play a football game. I'll never forget, we're in Pontiac, Michigan, in the Silver Dome when it first opened. Now, you got to remember, not that this has anything to do with it, but that thing was full of air. That's what kept that thing aloft. They had these fans. Did you ever play there?
I played there.
You remember how they had those big fans going constantly pushing air in there to keep that dome aloft, I guess. Jeez. But let me tell you this. We're in there, and this is the first time I'd ever noticed it. It's before the game, and I look up, and you can see around in there because that's where they got the luxury boxes and all this stuff. And people up there, they're boogalooing, and they're just getting down and getting drunk and all this stuff. And I thought to myself, what the hell is that? I guess what we do down here isn't good enough. They got to do that. I went back in time 2,000 years to the Coliseum.
Oh, you ain't not entertained.
Exactly. I was waiting for Mr. Ford to come out and give him a thumbs up or a thumbs down. Yeah, I was like all about stuff. That was like, it just messed my mind up like Dexter.
That's hysterical in all these stadiums now.
Yeah.
In these suites.
Exactly what's going on.
There are swimming pools, there's jacuzzis, it's a party, man. The game's there.
It really is. And you know what's interesting? 2 years ago, we were in Rome. I took the family, Coco and Hannah and my wife, Lisa Marie, and I, and we went through, which I got to be honest with you, it's kind of weird. Here it was, classic, the Roman Colosseum and all this history and everything that went on down there. And I was like, been here, done that. I mean, true, there weren't any real lions down there, and there weren't anybody with swords and all this, and you weren't going to lose your life.
Same vibe.
Reason, yeah, I mean, I just went, well, yeah, okay, 2,000 years later, maybe not as brutal, and I was getting paid pretty well, these guys were. But
they didn't have injured reserve back
it was,
then.
No. Riggo. Well, what I learned in this was, it's kind of interesting. What they on the tour, what they told you is not as many. It wasn't as, it was what it was, but I don't think it was quite as bloody as people want to make it out to be. In other words, the actual gladiators, when they were fighting, it wasn't always to the death. I think somebody could, if you didn't want to kill the guy, because you got to figure, you run out of gladiators. If they're every Sunday, you got, let's just say, on Sunday, Dallas and Washington. At the end of the day, if one of those teams is completely wiped out, or half of each team, then they got to go someplace the next Sunday. They need new gladiators.
That injury report looks pretty bad.
It's a numbers game. So that I think they pulled back a little bit. I think we've romanticized that a little bit. If there's such a thing as to romanticize,
it's all marketing.
I don't know. It's just good, good healthy entertainment.
Next time you take one of these overseas trip. Yeah. Let me come on, take the luggage and be your guy.
You just want to be a stowaway?
I want to go.
Oh, cool.
Wow.
I got to say this, though. Nowadays, I'm kind of like, first of all, I never have, it's not TSA or whatever security you got to go through, it's just like, oh, please, I don't, you know, because you're always scared. You got to go through this, got to do that. So my days of traveling may be over. I don't know. And now with COVID, I don't see anything on the horizon, unless it's here in the U.S.
We got to get you a NetJets. We got to get a NetJets,
a deal.
Little NetJets deal here on the John Riggins Show.
Yeah, that would work.
If you go to the Red,
Dex and me, oh, yeah, Dex, I'll take you personally to Rome and we get a NetJet deal.
For dinner tonight.
In. We get one of those. Dex, you and me, we're in.
I was getting ready to say the Red Rooster. No, in Russia. What's the, in Russia?
Moscow?
Moscow, yeah.
That's where you want to go?
I would like to go, yeah.
I don't know, Dex. I wouldn't. I just saw that deal on 60 Minutes.
Yeah, the guy that they gave. Pass on Moscow gave, right now.
Poison, the poison?
If they gave him some kind of military grade poison, going, ooh. And then I guess, what, after 48 hours? He just died. I don't want. He doesn't have any symptoms. He just died. There's no. You can't trace it after 48 hours. Now, did you see that?
I have not seen it yet. I recorded.
Have you heard it?
Oh yeah.
Did you watch it?
I saw a little bit of 6 minutes.
I think that's what they said. After 48 hours, there wouldn't be any symptoms left. All right, Dex. We're going to work on that NetJex deal, and you got to figure out where you want to go. Come to think of it, if you had one place you go, NetJets, you just fly there on a private plane. And you can be anywhere you want in the world. Where would it be?
Russia.
You want to go to Russia?
The Red Square.
Okay, Red Square. Well, that's Red cool. Square. I was thinking more like Fiji, maybe, or something like that. I don't know.
Yeah. I think. I don't have Russia in my top 10 there, but to each his own.
Maybe Patagonia. Maybe because I'm thinking, what do I go to Fiji for? I don't like beaches.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? I'm thinking at least Marie would be with me. So
there you go.
She would have wanted me to say Fiji.
There you go. All right. Well, that's going to conclude this edition of the John Riggins Show, and we'll be back on Friday. And no, Dexter, it's not Dallas, Washington week. That is no longer exist.
You think so?
There's no rivalry amongst these two franchises like it used to be. No. Sorry.
Well, now of all things,
right? Let's not manufacture it and be silly to and denigrate what you guys accomplished and what it truly meant back in the day.
Yeah,
it's not that now. Well, let's hope we're getting better and growing.
It's getting on its way. Anyway, guys, I got holes to dig. Riggo out.